Good enough. Well, thanks for that kind introduction. I've been at UK for about 18 months now, and it's great to, I will not walk in front of that. It's great to be over here and talk to you today about cost analysis. Many people wonder about it, hate it, love it. I'm just going to try to give you a high-level overview of the different types of cost analyses that you can employ, and in what situations you would want to use those types of analyses. I have collaborated probably for 25 years with clinicians in implementing cost analyses into their trials and their studies. So, without further ado, what do you mean you can't figure it out? It's not like it's rocket science. Oh yeah. So actually, this is definitely not rocket science. So you too can capture the basics here. It's kind of a bit more like this. So in the introduction you heard I have an undergraduate degree in accounting, which I left in the dust because I really hated auditing. No offense to any of you accountants in the room, but this is a lot about good accounting. Okay, so why care about costs? I am totally sympathetic to the view that we have to do what's best for our patients. And you may have situations where outcomes of two types of treatment are very similar, and it would come down to how much does it cost. You may have a situation where finances are limited, so you kind of want to know which one is going to give you the relatively more cost-effective alternative. Which one gives you more bang for the buck, sometimes you hear, okay? There's also a lot of situations where, can you guys still hear me? Okay, where there's a new technology, or you're considering a new technology, and in which case, these types of comparisons, costs and outcomes, become much more germane. I will also show you that some types of cost analysis can explicitly model or incorporate patient or societal preferences for certain types of outcomes, certain types of health trajectories, and I'll talk a little more about that. And as a practical matter, many of my colleagues have found that pairing their intervention proposal with a cost-effectiveness analysis can enhance dissemination and implementation and their likelihood of being funded by NIH. So I'll just put that out there too. Okay, so we're gonna start at the very bottom. How do you measure costs? Well, what kind of costs are we talking about? First, and what most people think about, direct medical costs. But we're also gonna talk about two other types of costs. What are direct medical costs? They're exactly what they sound like. Not rocket science, okay? All costs incurred by medical care providers during the study time frame. So pick the right study time frame and then make sure that you capture everything. So it's not just hospitalizations, it's not just physician visits, it's also prescription drugs. You can see how this can get quite a long list. If you really want to capture all medical costs, you've got to think about where are all the medical costs being incurred. But then we also worry about direct non-medical costs. And by this, we're talking about monetary costs that are incurred as a result of the disease or the condition and its treatment. So often these are not on a provider's radar screen, right? They're, does my rural patient have to stay in town for 30 days to have their radiation treatment, and how much does that cost? Or do they have to have a special diet because they had their oropharyngeal cancer resected and now they, you know, can't chew and swallow properly? So all these things are what we call direct non-medical costs. And they're often very important from a patient perspective. Okay, and then the final category, which very often is quite large, but also somewhat hard to measure, is indirect costs. These are non-monetary costs that are associated with the condition or its treatment. So work time lost, the caregiver's time, and in a child population, school days lost. So these again are very important from a patient perspective, but especially from societal perspective, if you talk about the burden of diabetes, you'll have the direct cost being one thing, the indirect cost often being larger than what it takes to treat the condition because of loss of life, loss of functionality, loss of ability to work. These are indirect costs. All right, another basic thing, how do we collect cost information? And there are a variety of ways. One of the, okay, now I have a little red thing here. Okay, here we go. Very often, we can do it alongside a randomized controlled trial. So you have a trial where patients are being randomized to particular treatments, and you're following them for a period of time, and you can collect information about their medical care. You can collect information from them about work time lost. You're doing it alongside, prospectively. A lot of times, because that is expensive, we can use secondary data sources. One of my favorite things to do is to look at claims data, which have this desirable quality of being very comprehensive on the medical care side. So no matter where they got their care, here versus Moorhead versus Atlanta, it's going to show up in the claims data. And then the last one, patient diary. Sometimes you can ask patients every time they come in, every 4 weeks or whatever, to complete a diary about various things, their medical care, their work days lost, the food that they're eating. You can get this patient self-report and either take it at face value or follow-up verification. There's a number of studies that use this approach. Some of you may be familiar with a very large data set called the Medical Expenditure Panel Survey, which is a national data set. They get patient self-report and then they follow up with providers to verify that they did indeed receive this care. Okay. All right. Oh, rats, I always do that. Now I've described each one of these. And so we've talked about the randomized controlled trial, primary data collection. The advantage is you have really good effectiveness data, right? You've got a randomized trial, so it's kind of clean. You don't have the different kind of biases that you get from observational data. The disadvantage, some people might argue with me, but I am a health services researcher, that randomized trials are limited in their ability to speak to real world delivery of medical care. It's, you know, you've got a rarefied set of inclusion criteria, and that limits the amount that you can talk about the rest of the world. Secondary data, as I talked about, the advantage, it's very cost-effective data, right? It's already collected, and it is more real world. The disadvantage is it's observational. So certain patients may, for various reasons, elect a certain treatment that is related to how well they will do with the treatment, and so it's not randomized, and it's harder to look at effectiveness. And then patient diary. The advantage, especially if a patient sees numerous providers or the things that only the patient can tell you or the person in your trial, the disadvantage, patient recall, is good for some things, not for other things, and definitely diminishes over time. Okay, and then once you have the, what I would call the utilization items, the things that you know are the areas where there's cost, you actually have to cost them out. Now that's an accounting term, but so basically if I know that you had, you know, three hospital stays, and one was 5 days, one was 7 days, one included a surgery, one didn't, you know, so how am I going to translate that into costs in a way that is comparable across patients and across providers? There are three ways that I will talk about. Actually, this is an issue that I want to talk about before I talk about the ways. Charges versus cost. How many of you have ever looked at a hospital bill? All right, what is the first thing that, okay, I won't do that. What is the first thing that you notice about a hospital bill?
The numbers are over the top, ridiculous.
The numbers are over the top, ridiculous. Hope we don't have too many administrators in the room, but that's exactly right. I say no basis in reality, because it's not, in general, it's not what's going to be paid, right? And why is that not what's going to be paid?
Insurance companies negotiate much lower rates.
Insurance, that's exactly right. So if you're insured, they have, the insurance companies are paying much different rates. And I could give you a whole talk on household payment, but I won't. But the fact of the matter is that charges and costs are actually not highly related, especially for hospital care, okay? Anybody take econ? Okay, come on, somebody, there we go, all right, cost curves, all right. So, in a hospital, we have very large fixed costs. We have the MRI, we have, you know, all the things that have to be paid for, whether you have one patient or 1,000 patients. And when you look at the cost of delivering something, a lot of times it's based on average cost. So if we see, 100 patients in a month, or we see 1,000, that very much changes the average cost for treating a patient. But it turns out that in doing these types of cost analysis, we're much more interested in the marginal cost. How much would it cost to treat one more patient? That's really the opportunity cost. And that's really what we're interested in. And invariably in a hospital, the average cost of doing something is much higher than the marginal cost, and average cost and price are more related. So for many reasons, we can't use charges, and we need to think about this concept of marginal cost. The other thing is that that's on the supply side. On the demand side, it has a lot to do with market forces. And if you think about, I'm truly trying to understand what are the resources that are being used to provide this service. It shouldn't have a lot to do with, you know, market competition and prices in that sense. So for a lot of reasons, we need to think carefully about how we measure cost.
Dr. Waters, may I ask a question?
Yep.
Is there a general period of time that organizations consider to be a reliable sampling period to define what average cost is? Is that a monthly balance sheet or quarterly, or is there a routine for that, or depends on the organization?
Yes, I'm going to talk a little bit about how we could, if we were doing a cost analysis for just for UK healthcare, there's a certain set of data and what kind of data they have for that, versus if we were trying to do a study like a clinical trial that had 6 sites and we were trying to. So I'll talk a little bit about how we come up with cost data. There's no perfect answer, and it has to do with their cost accounting. So understanding the accounting behind it helps to do these analyses. Other questions, feel free to ask. Okay. So the first and most common way that we see people getting to costs on the hospital side is applying something called the ratio of cost to charges, RCCs. It's really complicated, isn't it? No. By charges. So you get the charges and you say, I have data either from the hospital internal cost accounting or from something called the Medicare cost reports. I'll talk about that in a second. I have a source of RCC data and I will apply it to the charge information that I have to try to dial it back. Many studies, when there's multi-site, will leverage what's called the Medicare cost reports. What is that? Every year, every hospital that accepts Medicare payment has to file a Medicare cost report for their Medicare patients. Because Medicare patients often are more than half of a hospital's patient base, it's useful information. And what they're doing there is they're reporting by particular areas of the hospital what the ratio of cost to charges for that center are. So there might be one for pharmacy, there might be one for 2 North. I have no idea if that's a floor, but you see what I'm saying, that there is some of this detail that's done in a uniform way for all folks, all hospitals that report to Medicare. And these are publicly available data from CMS's website. So a lot of us try to leverage these because the way that there is, they have a formula for how they want hospitals to make these calculations. But they don't tend to be as detailed, and they're only for Medicare patients. So if a lot of your patients are Medicaid or children, which don't tend to be covered by Medicare, they're not as good to use. Many hospitals, most hospitals, also maintain their own RCC data. The problem is, and their cost account, they use their cost accounting methods to, you know, take costs and attribute it to units by square foot, by FTE. So essentially they're coming up with this ratio of cost to charges in their own way. And there's actually a relative lack of uniformity across hospitals about how they do this, because it's for their internal cost accounting purposes. It's not intended for, generally not intended for public consumption. But some, I have used it on occasion, but because it has advantages, I'm gonna go on from there. No more talk about RCCs. And then it's pretty simple, it's just math. So you're taking the RCC times what the charge was for a room. What if it's $1,000 a day, but the RCC was 0.5? So then $500 is the cost for that room for the day. And then you're just summing over all the utilization for that patient to get a cost. Again, it's not really rocket science, it's a lot more about accounting. Okay. So, strengths. It does avoid the distortions of charge data, but internal RCCs are good for one hospital, but not good across hospitals. The weakness is that RCC methodologies differ considerably. There's no perfect RCC way to adjust charges. Okay. On the outpatient side, we typically employ RVU data. I'm virtually certain that all of you have heard of RVUs. They're so much fun. Essentially, what happened in the 80s, there was a guy at Harvard, William Shao, who did this extensive study of everything that goes into producing a particular service, CPT service, current procedural terminology service, and assigned a relative value unit to that. So an office visit for a new patient might be 0.5 RVUs, a surgery, an extensive surgery might be 18 RVUs, okay? It's just sort of relatively what it takes. And since then, Medicare, actually the AMA has a group that updates these RVUs and adds new RVUs. It's a little bit of a political process, not going there right now. But let's just say you can convert this to a consistent cost estimate by using the multiplier factor that's published every year in the Federal Register, which is how Medicare comes up with its fee schedule. And we often use it because it's common across all kinds of settings. The advantage is it's standardized. The weakness is it's only as good as the underlying RVU data. So at one point, CMS decided we want to encourage primary care and not give as much to surgery, kind of ignoring sort of the underlying science under the RVUs. And so you have these adjustments that really don't have a lot to do with cost. But still, no perfect answer, this is what we use. All right, just a couple of other things, and I'm kind of breeze through this because it's there, but so we need to worry about the time horizon. We need to make sure that we're capturing long enough utilization to include the majority of events, but not so long as to capture things that are potentially unrelated. That is somewhat of a judgment call, a clinical call, really. We try to, most studies actually are published in US dollars, but you need to be careful when comparing studies from European countries, et cetera. And the other thing that is typically done is discounting. So first of all, if you're incurring costs and benefits over more than a year, you need to worry about inflation. So you are moving it to constant dollars. The other thing that a lot of people don't pay attention to is something called rate of time preference. This is not inflation. This is saying, I would rather have $100 today than $100 a year from now, right? And that has nothing to do with inflation. I'd just rather have $100 today. So what discount rate would make me indifferent between what I get today versus what I get a year from now? And economists typically use 3% or 5% as sort of standard. Okay. Now we're going to talk about the types of cost analysis. I know you've been holding your breath. All right, the simplest one is what we call a cost identification analysis. It's only looking at what are the costs. And why would you do that? Well, you might have a situation where the outcomes seem to be equivalent, or it's just really early, and you just want to know, sort of on average, how much does that procedure cost, or patients with that, getting that treatment, how much does that cost? So it might be used for reimbursement. It might be, it is generally used early. Here's an example, collaborated with a pediatric, allergy and immunology, somebody at Northwestern. And we looked at the cost of intermittent high-dose IV versus oral corticosteroids for the treatment of JDMS. Kind of a rare disease, not a lot of information. High-dose spelled wrong. I hate spell correct. This was kind of a new therapy at the time, and so we just basically wanted to look at the relative cost of the two approaches. And that is what we did. So we first quantified sort of what these averages were by treatment, and then started, again, plug and chug, just costing them out. So, but you get the idea. It's just very straightforward. You're trying to highlight where the cost differences are, but that's it. Another analysis that people use this term a lot, but they use it wrong a lot, is a cost-benefit analysis. These are studies that look at both costs and benefits, but they try to quantify both in terms of dollars. And that's not necessarily appropriate in a clinical setting, but let me show you when it is used. It is generally used for policy analysis. So if I'm trying to compare, should I, as a policymaker, invest in an immunization program, a new highway, a new school? So these are things where the outcomes are just so heterogeneous, I want to convert them to a common metric. And here's, I actually compiled three different studies. The first was, what's the cost benefit of having a national perinatal Hep B vaccine program? It would cost about $148 million. It would save about 663 lives. And here's where the rubber really meets the road. How much do you value a life? And it turns out there are widely varying uses of that amount, kind of hilariously so. So here, $1 million is the value of a life. This is a very squishy kind of science. How do you value a life, right? Some people use willingness to pay. So you say, how much would you be willing to pay to save your life? Well, then that depends on, do they have to have the money to say how much, right? Because that's going to be about, let's see, $21? No. So the answer is generally no. We don't require that they have the money in hand. But we actually use a little bit more, slightly more nuanced approach to thinking about this. What we say is, if you could have some intervention that would reduce your likelihood of death by 0.01, how much would you be willing to pay for that? And that is actually kind of what policymakers do. So this will reduce, at a population level, it will reduce the likelihood of death by a very small fraction. And asking people how much they'd be willing to spend to reduce that likelihood of death is a way of capturing cost per life year, estimate of a life. So, but you'll see that these three use three different numbers for a value of a life. Is that locked? Okay. This This second one, which was the cost for enhanced seatbelt enforcement, right? That will save lives, but it takes people. You have to stop people and take a look at their seatbelt, right? That takes people. They valued life using something called the present discounted value of future earnings for an average person in South Africa, which is always going to give you the lower estimate. Sorry, we're not just the sum of our future earnings, all right? And then the last one, they used $3 million per life. Now, this I found fascinating. So when you value life more, most of your programs seem that much greater, right? Because for every life you save, it's valued higher. Turns out that the Department of Transportation, U.S. Department of Transportation, uses $3 million in all their estimates. Gets more people to support their programs. Anyways, you get the idea. Cost benefit is dollars to dollars. And the math all comes down to how much do you value a life. In clinical settings, the most likely cost analysis that you're going to want to do is something that we call a cost effectiveness analysis. And it studies that they do compare costs and outcomes, but here the outcome is somewhat clinical. Most commonly we use what's called life years or quality adjusted life years saved, and I'll talk a little bit about that. But it could be other intermediate outcomes. So I've done papers where we looked at infections avoided or, you know, cost per misdiagnosis. So you can have an intermediate sort of clinical outcome that you really care about. The reason we try to do life years or quality adjusted life years is because that allows us to compare antihypertensive medications and, you know, increasing a surgery, or you can compare across a variety of clinical interventions and still know whether something is relatively cost effective compared to other things. Okay, so we talked about this. All right, so QALYs is very often used in the literature. It is sort of a standard, but there are other things that you can do, especially if you, it's very early on in a new treatment. Okay, so our key metric that we're focusing on is something called an ICER, the incremental cost effectiveness ratio. And it's as simple as this. What is the additional cost for the additional benefit? Okay? You can also think about it this way if you're spatially oriented. Without the intervention, somebody would, you know, have really good health now, but very rapidly their health would decline. They would have lower health-related quality of life, and they would die. Suppose we have another intervention that would extend your better quality of life and increase your length of life. Then the incremental quality is B, the yellow area. Okay, so that helps you. Essentially what we're trying to do with quality adjusted life years is add up not just the years, but the quality of those years. So we tend to set perfect health at a 1.0 and death at a 0, although many people say there are things worse than death. This doesn't quite, living with something really horrible you might rather, but generally we kind of don't worry about that too much. And we use a variety of approaches to figure out where you would be with the treatment or where you would be, you know, in a particular year. And that's very much patient reported.
Question for you on that one. Is age also a factor? Like people in their 70s and 80s and their quality adjusted life years, is it valued more or less than somebody?
It's not because it's patient reported, but you can imagine that somebody at 70 might have a shorter horizon. So it is important to think about sort of life expectancy with and without that treatment and how they would weight those things, because somebody getting treated at 70, it might add 1 year, whereas somebody treated at 50, it might add 5 or 10. So and we would just collect all that information and average across the patient population. Okay. You may have seen something like this, but this is conceptually what's going on. If you plot the differences in cost, where this is, they're the same right here, this vertical. Oh, I have a red thing, that's right. So this is where there's no change in cost, this line here, and below here, it is less, the intervention is less costly, and here it is more costly. And then here we look at the effectiveness, where this line is, they're the same effectiveness, this is less effective, this is more effective. So basically, if we are more costly and worse outcomes, we can immediately say we don't want that intervention. And if it is better effects and less costly, we always want that. So these two are very straightforward. It's here on these off diagonal that the opportunities for trade-offs exist. And then you want to be on which side of this diagonal, where do you want to be? Okay, so conceptually, when we do our cost effectiveness analysis, we're trying to figure out, are we F or C, or D or E? Okay, now we'll take a toe in the water of the complexity of cost effectiveness analysis. Because generally the way that we do this is to not only sort of conceptually think about cost versus effectiveness, but consider that there is uncertainty in outcomes and uncertainty in cost. And that uncertainty we generally incorporate into something called a decision tree. This is an example of a decision tree that was published in JAMA Pediatrics, where they're looking at strategies for offering influenza vaccine in the pediatric ED. And here are the strategies. Vaccinate only children under 5. Vaccinate all kids who come in. Vaccinate only high-risk kids. And don't vaccinate at all. So 4 strategies. And they blow up the tree on one of them, but basically there's every option has its own set of tree. So if you think about the vaccinate all strategy, and this will be comparable in the other strategies, you're going to have kids who are eligible for a vaccine and some who are, it's contraindicated. Then you're going to have older and younger than 5, and again, the tree will blow up from over and under 5, high risk, low risk, accepts, does not accept, has adverse effects, has fever, has a site reaction, has anaphylaxis. So you're basically taking it out to all the possible outcomes that branch off every approach that you take. All right?
I have a question.
Yep.
Is this logic model only going to only be applied to children who are already in the ED?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So
this is
another reason or
this particular paper, and sorry, I've collaborated with a lot of pediatricians, so a lot of my examples are peds. This particular example is saying, what is the, you know, kids show up at the ED, should we vaccinate all of them? And if we don't do that, is there some other strategy less than that that dominates, that is more cost effective? So they basically outline these 4 strategies. Then you can see that there's all kinds of events happening here. We need to know the probabilities with which those events are happening. And often based on literature, or it could be from one of your trials, you could actually use a trial to generate some of these probabilities. You're looking at the probability that a child has influenza when they're coming in. You're looking at whether they'll accept the vaccination, whether it will be effective, how many of your patients will be high risk, you know, so how many of them will develop otitis media. So it's basically you're getting data to populate this tree. And there's 2 ways that you do that. Again, you could have your own trial data, or you can get it from the literature, or some combination of the two. And often I've done some combination of the two. So this is their take-home message. They got all this data, they put it in the tree, and they found that offering the vaccine to all patients was more cost effective. And in this case, look, they did not do qualies. They did cost per influenza case averted. So they included the cost of the vaccine, the cost of the complications, et cetera, all the probabilities. They found out that the cost was $114.45 for that strategy, and that was $33.51 less than any other strategy. So they say that routine influenza vaccine, the pediatric ED, would be cost effective from a societal perspective. Any pediatricians? Are we doing comprehensive influenza vaccine in the ED? Sometimes there's a breakdown between what we find in the literature and what actually happens in practice. I'm sure that surprises you. Okay, so I want to give enough time for a few questions, but let's just recap. So which cost analysis? If the outcomes are similar or unknown, cost identification. If the outcomes and costs differ, or there's very limited finances, we often go to a cost effectiveness analysis. That's sort of the sweet spot. If we are comparing health and non-health programs, that's the cost benefit. I have to tell you, I've done two of those in my career. I've published two. It just doesn't, that's not the space we're generally in. For formal consideration of patient or societal preferences, your outcome often should be quality adjusted life years. You're thinking about how they view those life years that you're saving. And then finally, if you want to enhance your dissemination and implementation, which is the latest rage in NIH funding, I think either of these approaches, cost identification or cost effectiveness. I will admit that cost effectiveness is relatively complex. I've had some clinicians who got interested enough to learn the most common software, which is called Triage, but a lot of times it's good to collaborate with somebody who does understand this software. So, questions?